In the 1950s, entomologists discovered that insects were developing resistance to pesticides because of their overuse and abuse. Environmentalists were concerned about the damage and danger of pesticides to the environment. In the 1960s, Rachel Carson's book Silent Spring alerted the public to problems with pesticides. The concept and impetus for integrated pest management, IPM, grew out of the discontent with using a purely insecticidal approach to insect control in many areas in the 1950s. Historically, IPM was promoted first during the 1960s as a result of the failure of chemical insecticides, notably in cotton production, where regions needed at least 12 sprayings per crop. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'm going to talk about integrated pest management. The U.S. Code defines integrated pest management as a sustainable approach to managing pests by combining biological, cultural, physical, and chemical tools in a way that minimizes economic, health, and environmental risks. IPM is not a difficult concept to understand, and it relates to everyone. Every person has had an experience with one time or another with some sort of pest. To begin understanding IPM, consider each term individually. Integrate means to bring multiple parts together into a unified whole. A pest is an organism which humans feel is in an undesirable location. Management refers to controlling or handling a pest problem, not exterminating the pest problem. So IPM involves using a variety of methods or tactics to keep a pest organism at an acceptable population level. IPM promotes being proactive to prevent pest problems rather than being reactive to a pest problem that has gotten out of hand. Successful IPM requires an understanding of both the population processes, such as life cycle, competition, and the effects of natural controls, and environmental factors such as weather, soil conditions, availability of water, etc. Efforts are made to conserve the long-term health and productivity of the ecosystem. We often depict IPM as a triangle of tools, with prevention of pests being at the base and chemical control being the smallest part of the triangle. In IPM, pesticides are not eliminated as a control method, but is used as a tool along with the other management methods. Traditional pest control resulted in pest overkill and considerable quantities of unnecessary and undesirable pesticide residues in the environment. Pest management aims to maintain insect populations below a threshold. You can see in this table some of the differences between standard pest control and IPM. Standard pest control is chemically intense, reactive, emphasizes killing pests directly, and the purpose of the visit is to apply pesticides. You may recall the pest control guy visiting your house with his spray can in his hand. He wouldn't ask what the problems were, he would just start spraying. Integrated pest management is a knowledge-intense, systematic, emphasizing prevention of pests and modification of conditions, and the purpose of the visit is to inspect and monitor. Whenever you think about maximizing yields and profits, it is really important to know the system. First, you must know what the plant normally looks like so that you know when it starts to look abnormal. Surprisingly, most plant health problems are not caused by biotic living factors like insects or disease. Typically, plants are stressed or sick because of abiotic factors, such as uncontrollable adverse weather or environmental conditions, or as a result of growers overmanaging. Some cultural practices, such as overwatering or fertilizing, can make crop plants and fields very attractive to insects or promote disease. To confirm biotic factors are damaging plants, proper identification of the pest or disease is critical to successful management. Note the type of plant it was found feeding on as well as the observed damage. Chewing pests like beetles or caterpillars will remove leaf material. Brown or yellow speckling on leaf surfaces may indicate piercing sucking damage from pests like aphids, lace bugs, or spider mites. Secondary symptoms like sooty mold on tops of leaves may suggest that aphids, whiteflies, or soft scales have been feeding on the leaves above. Once the pest is identified, you need to understand the pest's biology, life cycle, and conditions it requires to survive. Where does it live? What does it eat? Does it undergo metamorphosis? Why is it here? What is it looking for to live? Answering these questions can help you develop a strategy for long-term management. Knowing how to find the target insects will help you accurately describe what's going on in the field. Insects usually have a preferred feeding site, whether it's the leaves, stems, or flowers. For example, some insects cause more damage along edges of fields, especially near grassy edges. Some feed only at night, while others are constantly eating. Knowing how to find the target insects will help you accurately describe what's going on in the field or greenhouse. Some common tools to estimate density include a sweep net for larger insects like beetles and moths, blue or yellow sticky traps for small flying insects like whiteflies, and pheromone traps for certain moths. Make sure you turn over leaves since many insects feed on the underside. For tiny insects like thrips and mites, you can do a tap test where you tap the plant over white paper to look for movement. A good hand lens is integral for scouting since many piercing-sucking insects are small. It is best to keep a record of your scouting efforts for future planting as well as seeing if your control efforts are successful. Note how many there are on a certain number of plants, where the pests are located, and are there male, females, or offspring present. All insects' populations go through high and low cycles. Some might peak several times a year, while others may peak only every few years. Scouting will help you describe density over time. This is a figure of a typical insect population scenario. Each dot represents a sampling date. Note that the numbers were very high in 2008, with a peak of over 500 insects per plant in mid-August. Compare that with 2009, where the numbers remained low throughout the season. The fourth step is to establish an action threshold. What is the point when a pest population is large enough that something must be done to manage it? A decision must be made about the level of acceptable damage. In ornamental landscapes, any level of damage is often unacceptable. The action threshold depends on the type of pest, the plant involved, the function of the crop or landscape, and how much control measures will cost. Damage and aesthetic thresholds can assist with these decisions. Timing is crucial. For example, immature scale insects in the crawler stage are more susceptible to insecticide. The economic injury level and economic threshold is often based on extensive research done by the university. It is beneficial to have this information, although not all crops, pests, and systems have this, so some self-experimentation may be required. In this example, research at the University of Florida determined an economic threshold of 8 thrips per flower on the southern highbush blueberry cultivar Emerald, while Star was only 4 thrips per flower. Based on scouting, this provides blueberry growers with a specific pest level to treat and still keep their yields profitable. Step 5 is to consider and select multiple tactics for pest management. This uses the pyramid of tactics and integration of cultural, physical, biological, and chemical actions you can take. Strategies should be compatible. For example, the chemicals used should not kill both pests and beneficials. The following slides will show you the various types of strategies. The first strategy I'll talk about is cultural control. These are strategies that manipulate the surrounding environment to promote plant health and minimize pest abundance. Since insects often sense stressed hosts, by performing regular agricultural practices that would increase your yield, you can also decrease the susceptibility to pests. We'll focus on some of these. If you can keep pests out in the first place, it is the best strategy. Take a look at what plants are coming in and reject any that may already have insects or diseases on them. This also means don't shop for plants in the clearance aisle. Have you ever gone to one of the box stores and saw a plant for a dollar? You may have said, oh, I can nurse it back to health. Well, you may be bringing back problems as well. Also, select varieties that help minimize yield loss. Genetic control is largely based on improvements in seed quality. Starting with high-yielding varieties is often worth the extra cost to improve plant health before the insects arrive. Some varieties are bred for genetic resistance or tolerance to an insect or group of insects or other pests. Desirable genetic traits have been selected for many years by breeders, and now certain traits can be modified by molecular techniques to alter the plant to protect yield. Insects that feed on resistant plants don't survive or do as well as they normally would. For example, the potato leafhopper is a common pest in alfalfa. Glandular-haired alfalfa varieties are a genetic improvement that discourages the leafhoppers from doing as well because they have difficulty feeding on hairy leaves. Some plants have been genetically modified, such as Bt corn or cotton, where the genes of the toxins of Bacillus thuringiensis are introduced into the crop. This provides continuous protection and elimination of financial and environmental costs of insecticide use. You can reduce the favorability of the ecosystem through a number of ways. First and foremost is to keep the area sanitary. This may mean crop residue destruction if a pest can live on that, elimination of animal waste, or efficient storage and processing. By knowing the biology of the pest, you can destroy or modify alternate hosts and habitats. For example, some pests like aphids may be living in weeds surrounding the property, then moving in on your crop. You can also obscure host presence. An example of this is using silver mulches surrounding greenhouses or over raised beds to confuse western flower thrips. Since a large majority spend some part of their life stage in the soil, tilling can disrupt this cycle. Birds also think caterpillars on the surface of the soil are a tasty treat. Irrigation and water management can also be an effective control depending on the pest. Although proper watering of a plant can make it thrive more, techniques such as flooding a field can suppress soil pests. There are several strategies to disrupt or divert the pest. Probably the most important method is to rotate from one crop to another in alternative plantings. Although this also improves soil structure and fertility, it also decreases the host population compared to monocropping. A common rotation in Florida is rotating peanuts and cotton. Cover crops often include cereals or legumes. Cover crops left in borders can also increase beneficial insects. Trap cropping uses a plant that is more attractive to the pests than the main crop. One type of trap cropping I've used is planting sunflower around the perimeter to trap stink bugs. You have to make sure to kill the stink bugs in the trap crop with a quick-acting permethrin, preferably in the early evening after the bees have returned to their hives, so they don't move to your crop. Intercropping involves growing dissimilar crops in the same location. This can reduce pest populations since they do not have as much material to reproduce on. A similar concept is companion planting, where the plant chosen helps the plant by either aiding in pest control, plant productivity, or pollination. Physical or mechanical control refers to methods that destroy pests by physically removing or excluding them. These can include hand removal, such as using a paintbrush to take off piercing, sucking pests on valuable plants in a greenhouse, spraying pests with water to dislodge them, and pruning them. Traps can be a mechanical control and include the same methods as monitoring. In this photo, you see a pheromone trap for the vine mealybug. Some physical controls include covering fruit for protection from pests like these banana covers to prevent fruit flies from laying eggs. Biological control is purposeful natural enemy manipulation to obtain a reduction in a pest status. The goal is to establish a self-sustaining system which is based on food supply and reproductive capability of the natural enemy. It includes predators, parasites or parasitoids, and microbes. There is another video specifically on biological control. The last control strategy is chemical control. This should be used as a last resort and should start with the least toxic insecticide first. More information on this topic will be in another video. The final step of IPM is to evaluate the results. Keeping detailed notes on scouting, timing of applications, and costs is important when developing and evaluating an IPM program. Did the tactics chosen work? What should have been done differently? How can this problem be prevented from happening again? There are several benefits to using IPM, including that it's easy to implement once you have developed the program, providing a healthier ecosystem, and providing good public relations. It can also be cost-effective, increase beneficial insects, and decrease pesticide resistance.